Well, thank you for the warm welcome. As I have told a couple of people, Cape Town is getting to be my second home. This is my fourth visit here since 2000, and I'm going to be back in March, apparently. So I'm getting to South Africa quite a bit, which is, to me, an incredible thing, since I live in the... I was going to say boring, but since we have a certain president, it's become a much more interesting place. I'm always glad to come here to Cape Town. I think this is one of the most beautiful places in the world. And as a friend of mine said, you know, if you can get a group of physicists to I think it was Lenny Susskind who said this, if you can get a physicist to come to Cape Town once, you're almost guaranteed to get him or her to come back. So if you guys just keep inviting us, I think you'll find that there will be an ever-increasing crowd of physicists making the long trek from wherever it is to come to enjoy this beautiful environment. This is one of my cartoons, my favorite acquisitions. I have a great graduate student. So first of all, I'm like most professors. You know, professors get credit for all this stuff, but students know who really do the work, right? It's not the professors per se. We come up with these grand overarching ideas, and then you have to have talented young people like in this audience who go out and actually, to a large extent, make these ideas come true. And this is actually an animation that my graduate student, Mr. Kenneth Griggs, developed on the basis of some discussions we had. And I'm going to start my talk by asking a question. In fact, now, first of all, I have to disqualify some people because, where's Katrin? You're here. You're disqualified from this, so you can't answer the question. And probably shouldn't let you talk about it either, John. It's too obvious. But for those of you in the audience who are not specialists, tell me what you think you're looking at. You're out, too. I said not specialists. You're out. So I mean I want some young answers, some fresh new answers. I'm sorry. I want some immature answers. So for some young people in the audience, what do you think you're looking at?
Wrinkly.
Say again?
I think I'm a wrinkly.
I'm a
wrinkly. I'll say the
pulse with grid lines. Ah, I guess it gives it away. Yes, this is true, but this is supposed to be a representation of a particular system. And in particular, what's this stuff that's coming off? I'm sorry? Gravitational waves. That's exactly right. This is a cartoon animation of something that is part of my presentation today. And it's something that's rather interesting because, let me start this over and give you a slightly different version of this. You know, if you go out one night and look in the sky, in the right frequency range, you would see flashes of light coming to Earth. And if you went to the location where those flashes are coming from, you would then find, often case, something like this going on. This is a binary pulsar system. In fact, this is a sort of a cartoon representation of the Hulse-Taylor pulsar, which in fact led to a Nobel Prize. We're zooming in, and these, as someone said, this stuff that you see coming off are actually gravity waves. They're curvature of space and time, at least some sort of cartoon representation. Much as if you took two balls in the surface of a pond and ran them around and around, you could see the ripples coming off. You would see gravity waves coming off this object. And gravity waves were predicted, of course, by Albert Einstein and his great triumph of 1916. But we've never seen these. And so this cartoon is representing something that we hope will occur within the next 5 to 10 years, maybe a little bit longer, that you'll have a great gravity wave coming and going to a familiar blue marble and its accompanying companion, traveling at the speed of light because gravity waves are like light waves. They travel at the speed of light. And when they encounter this blue marble, if we're lucky and we can get everything to work just right, what's going to happen is going to be this. It will land in the state of Washington. On the ground in Washington, there's this L-shaped structure with arms about 1.7 kilometers each leg. And when a gravity wave hits, it does this, which is, of course, pretty violent and dramatic. So let me stop this because that's the end of our presentation here. But that was too violent to be real. So let's talk about a little bit of reality here. There we go. how much were those arms really going to be moving? Well, that's what this one's about here. Let me show you what it's really like. This is, again, as I said, all my graphics I have to give my graduate student for, because we talk about these things, but he pulls magic to do this. This is a cartoon representation of a helium atom. The blue balls are the protons. The slightly yellowish balls are the neutrons. And the little things that you see inside of them are cartoon representations of quarks. These are the fundamental constituents of matter. Quarks being discovered about the time I graduated from high school. And you'll notice there's this red line that's there that you might think that's actually an imperfection in the slide. But in fact, that's the distance that the arms of the LIGO experiment are expected to move from one side of that red line to another at the scale where the atom looks this big. So what's going to be attempted to be measured at LIGO is an incredibly small shift in the arms, not those big violent cartoon shifts that you saw in my presentation, but very, very small shifts. And so the theory of gravitation and fundamental physics, which is what we've been talking about this school, presents some enormous and amazing opportunities. Now, these things are not going to get you to be a millionaire. You're not going to overtake Bill Gates if you make one of these discoveries in terms of money. If you're lucky, you might get a Nobel Prize if you just happen to hit the right thing at the right time. But mostly what this kind of science does is add to the bulk of knowledge that our species uses to make advances. In particular, when I land at the airport at Cape Town, invariably, I go and rent one of these things, cell phone. Nothing you'd think special about it, but the basic science for this started about 150 years ago when James Clerk Maxwell wrote down four equations, which were themselves an amalgam of work that had gone on for about 30 years. Many scientists contributed to Maxwell's equations, but his equations, once he wrote them down, predicted that you could send signals through space and time. And that's those signals that we use to build these devices. So the start of this is about 150 years ago. The kind of science that we're talking about here in this school doesn't add to the bottom line tomorrow. It doesn't add 10 years from now. It doesn't add possibly even a century from now. But on the order of several centuries, if we get it right now, it can make enormous differences for what our species is doing. And now this is, for the businessman, this is too long a time span because there's this thing called return on investment. But for those of us who love the doing of science, this is what I think is one of the things that drives us, having a role to play where the impact is several hundred years into the future. It's a rare chance. It's a long gamble. It's a long-term gamble that you're taking. But it's part of doing the excitement, for me, part of doing science is that you actually get a chance to be perhaps one of those people making such a contribution. Now, actually, today, I was confused about my presentation because I was told to prepare a popular talk. And so I said, okay, I can do that really easily. Popular talk, by the way, to physicists means talk about your ideas, but don't tell them anything about the mathematics. That's possible to do. The Elegant Universe, this DVD that Cliff was talking about and that Brian is the main host of, is exactly along those lines. There's essentially no mathematics in the DVD presentation, but it contains the essence of the ideas for how this piece of science has reshaped our view of the world. And it is only a theoretical piece of science. And in talking to the public about string theory, I'd like to be very clear that as we specialists have talked among ourselves, string theory has not one iota of experimental support at this time. It simply does not. What it does have is an incredible amount of mathematical support. String theory has had many, many, many chances to fail as a consistent piece of mathematics, and yet it has not. And every time someone thinks that they've gotten it to fail, they had to turn around and said, no, it actually works. So it's a piece of mathematical physics. We hope it will become physics. We hope that there will be a time when we can look back and say those people in the 60s through the Because string theory actually starts at the end of the 60s. But those people from the 60s to the 01, 010 period started a piece of science that looks like Maxwell's equations when you look back several hundred years. What does that actually mean? Well, string theory is about the very essence of everything, but in particular, it's about space and time. You know how, even though we have this expression, empty space, you know what people say, oh, you don't want to fill up that empty space, or go fill up that empty space. Well, according to Einstein, space isn't empty at all. It's a thing. That's an incredible concept, that space is a thing. And in fact, that cartoon that I just showed you is a representation of the fact that it's a thing, because that waving motion is the waving of something. So space and time is a thing, according to Einstein. It's not nothingness. It's quite a different concept. Now, we know these sorts of things because of the equations that we work with. And so today when I was told to prepare a public talk, earlier today was told, but public means it's mostly just going to be the physicists here. And then I turned around and said, oh, my God, well, the presentation that I had presented was not really aimed for the physicists. It was aimed for general people, normal people, quote, unquote, as opposed to folks like us who people often say aren't quite normal, or there are lots of ways to describe us. But, we, by the way, relativity says that we think we're normal, and never mind. But so I was in this quandary, but I think I'm going to ask how many normal people in the audience? Please raise your hand. Oh, my God. How many physicists are in the audience? Okay. How many others? Okay, so you see, my quandary is, which talk do I give? Because, in fact, I prepared several talks. And do I give the one for the physicist, or do I give the one for the non-physicist? And so I'm... Give the one for the non-physicist. Okay.
We have an empty slot on Friday. You give the other
one. Oh, really? Okay, fine. Then I'll give the talk for the non-physicist with that little encouragement. So let's start talking about for the non-physicists. What is it that we crazy string theorists are up to? Well, I start with this cartoon, Powers of Ten. And if I took this pin and cut it into 10 equal pieces and throw away 9 and keep 1, I get something about that big. If I take that one piece, cut it into 10 equal pieces, keep 9, to throw away 9 and keep 1, I get something about the length of my fingernail. Let me keep doing that process over and over again. That's what this cartoon is about. If you do this 5 times, you're down to the size of blood cells. If you continue this process of taking an object, cutting it 10 equal pieces, throwing 9, keeping 1, you can go to 10 to the minus 6, and at 10 to the minus 9, you're already down to the strands of DNA, very important part of our science today with the Genome Project. You can keep continuing this process down in size, and if we continue, and here we zoom in on a single strand of DNA, you can get down to the size of an atom. So this cloud of the electron clouds, or cartoon representation thereof, the electron clouds around the atom. We're going to continue shrinking in size. We get smaller than the shell, so we get inside. And for a long time, you see nothing until about 10 to the minus 14 or 15. You begin to see the protons and neutrons of the nucleus, the little balls inside of the quarks we're putting there just for completeness. And now, where is string theory? Well, assuming my technology is going to continue to support me, we go racing along in size, doing this process over and over and over again until near the bottom of our clock, we have done this process 35 times. And at that point, if this idea is correct, there is something there. This something is a little wiggling, jiggling piece of matter and energy and space and time. The way to think about this thing, interestingly enough, is if you say DNA encodes how to build life, then strings encode how to build existence. They are the genetic code carriers for existence, if this idea is correct. They are precisely 1 billion, billion, billion times smaller than ordinary DNA. Because you'll find out that's exactly a factor of 10 to the 27. So that's the idea of string theory. Now, this is such an incredibly small arena, which we now quickly review here, that it means that none of our present-day technology allows us to have access directly to scales that size. What essentially happens if you stop and think a little bit about the way science works, the when you want to look smaller, it costs more money. That's the simplest way to think of it. Because if you want to get one of those handheld microscopes, you can see things down to the size of, I think it's about 10. Is anyone here expert in optics? I don't know. You can easily see things on the order of 10 to, say, the minus 4 or 5 with a microscope. If you want to see smaller than that, you got to get an electron microscope. Well, that's a big jump in cost from a little handheld piece of glass, this big electronic device. If you want to see smaller than that, you go to things called atomic force microscopy. Again, a huge jump in order to see smaller. If you want to go smaller than that, then you start getting into the realm of particle accelerators. Things, these large devices that people build around the world. The principal one being at CERN right now, they're about to build the LHC, the Large Hadron Collider, which will be the world's most powerful particle accelerator. And when you build these large accelerators, they let you look real small. So this new accelerator will be the world's most powerful accelerator. It's the most expensive accelerator. We will be able to look very, very small with it. But with the entire cost of now several continents, because Europe is investing in the LHC, the United States is investing in LHC. I don't know if there are physicists here in South Africa, but, very good. Yes, I know that you are. But the point is that now you're starting to see an entire world invest into a device. And what do you get out of all that money and intellectual capital that goes there? You get to see physics that is on the scale of tables that we just looked at. In some rough ways, you're going to be looking at, say, around 10 to the 18 or 19, roughly speaking, in terms of energy scales. That's still a long, long way from 10 to the minus 35. And at that point, you're consuming trillions of dollars. That's the way to think of it. So we neither have the technology nor the will to take all of the economic output of our planet and then begin to investigate these tiny things. So the only way that we have to do this now is with mathematics. And that's what my community and Melanie's not here, but there's about 1,000 or maybe 2,000 of us around the world who have been looking at the mathematics associated with this idea. And that's what we can tell you about. No one can tell you about any experiments because we don't have any experimental data. But what we can do is tell you about the mathematics. Well, this isn't mathematics. So why in the world am I wasting your time? Well, this is a piece of music that I'm going to use in a certain way. And I like this piece of music because if you look in the title up here, you'll see that there's a certain word there that somehow I have an affinity for. This piece of music, and by the way, you are listening to the actual piece of music, was written by Mozart. And the thing that's interesting about this is to think about how we humans experience music. It comes in two modes. There is this, which musicians and people who learn how to read music understand very well. That's one way of understanding music. But there is also our simple, untrained pleasure at listening to music being played. Now, you see, roughly speaking, physics is like that. For the physicist, we know how to read the scales associated with our ideas. It's all mathematics. It's all mathematics. Mathematics, as Tony Z spoke about earlier today, has proven to be an unreasonably effective tool for humans to understand how nature works. It is the only one of our human languages that lets us, with great precision, describe what happens in nature. So mathematics turns out to be a very unusual human language. It constrains our imagination in certain ways because there's an internal logic and consistency of mathematics. But the other thing that mathematics does, which is extremely strange and much like music, is if you teach someone how to play music, and let's imagine a world where only classical music was taught for generations and generations, and then a bright kid comes along, you teach them how to play classical music, and this bright kid has a different vision and decides to go off and create jazz. It's a different kind of music. this person has learned all the rules of classical music, but because of a particular kind of vision, they have rearranged those rules and come up with something new. Mathematics does precisely the same thing for us. We learn a lot of mathematics starting from school up to university, and there it looks like it is completely rigid. It looks like you have absolutely no freedom in setting the rules. That's like being trained on classical music. But by the time you reach my stage and the stage of one's career where you're getting your PhD in physics, what you come to understand as a theoretical physicist is that it in fact is not constraining. That at that stage you have learned the rules sufficiently well that you can begin to dream up new ideas. And at that point, you're making up the rules. It's absolutely like you're composing the music. And so that's what we theoretical physicists have been doing. And this is what our composition looks like. It's sets of equations. These equations here are the basic equations of string theory. This quantity X is what was is a mathematical description of that little jiggling, wiggling, closed object that you saw in my cartoon. These things are, you have to use, it turns out calculus is the basic language of string theory. So you got to know something about calculus. You got a bunch of derivatives thrown in, that's what these things are. And this, as I said, in the simplest formulation of string theory, and the fact that one that was first discovered, this is essentially what people do. What was done was that this object was introduced and people began to try to understand how could it describe physics. Well, it turns out that in its first incarnation, it was totally wrong. And let me skip ahead because I actually have this presentation. Well, I don't know. Most of you are familiar with the standard model or not. If I say standard model, does that mean anything? I see no motion over here. I'll try it one more time. If I say the word standard model, does that mean anything? Yes? Okay. So I'm going to skip the part of my discussion on the standard model and move ahead. I'm sorry, speak up. You don't think I should? Okay. Those were the physicists nodding. I see. And those are the ones that were normal by their own definition. Gotcha. Okay, so we're going to review the standard model in lightning quick fashion. The standard model is our present day best understanding of how our universe is put together. Parts of the standard model tell us that in nature we see these things called protons, neutrons, and electrons, and they form atoms. So this is a cartoon of an atom. I've actually just drawn the nucleus here. We didn't put the electrons in this picture. But over here, these two blobs of light represent the electrons that whirl around the nucleus of the atom. Here we just chose helium. And it turns out that all of these small objects behave as if they're spinning. We'll come back to this later. But it turns out that the electron, which is the E symbol here, is a member of a family of six objects called leptons. And there is a nature, another object that's about 200 times as heavy, but in all other ways behaves exactly like an electron. It's called a mu particle. And then there's also in nature another object 1,700 times the mass of the electron, but in all other ways has the property of the electron. It's called the tau particle, discovered about a decade ago. Each of these particles seem to be accompanied by friends. There's a particle called the neutrino. A neutrino is kind of an electron without charge, but in many ways it behaves like an electron. It also has an incredibly small mass compared to the electron. In fact, it's on the scale where the electron would be 5 times 10 to the minus 4, this thing has a mass that's 5 orders of magnitude smaller. And this discovery that it has mass has only been made within the last 5 years. We thought these things had no mass at all for a very long time. And so there are three of them, the neutrinos. Remember we talked about protons and neutrons having these little objects inside of them called quarks? Well, here's some cartoons of our protons and neutrons. A proton consists of two up quarks and one down quark. A neutron is two down quarks and one up quark. And so we think it's pairs of threes that make up things like protons and neutrons. Notice that these things are colored. Well, that's not just a cartoon. There's a mathematical property that those colors represent. And each quark that's in the interior of a hadron, in fact, has a different one of these mathematical properties. The quarks come in a large number. There are, first of all, what we call six flavors of quarks. That's reading down the table. There's up, down, charm, strange, top, and beautiful. It That's what the letters stand for. But each of those letters is triplified by color. So, in fact, there are not 6 quarks, but 18, because you have to multiply by 3. They have a range of masses. Their charges are rather strange. The up quark, we believe, has 2/3 units of charge on the proton, while the down quark has 1/3 the unit of charge on the electron. So they're not coming in integer charges, which is what we see in everyday world around us for charged particles. And then they all spin at the same rate. As I said, this property of color is a mathematical property that we believe is fundamental to the structure of quarks and leads to a theory called quantum chromodynamics. Quarks also come in pairs, but it's actually a quark and an antiquark that pair off together. So these pairs of objects are called mesons. This is what happens when you bring matter and antimatter together. If any of you are fans of Star Trek, perhaps you remember the episode of Kirk and the Anti-Kirk. And they were locked in this bubble. And the anti-Kirk really wants to get the Kirby so he can destroy the universe. Well, that's science fiction. But in the real world, if you bring an electron and an anti-electron together and let them be at the same place, you in fact get a ball of light where all of the energy that formerly was there in the form of mass is converted into principally high energy gamma rays. And so antimatter turns out is real. It's not a product of science fiction. And in fact, antimatter was discovered not by science fiction people, but by a biophysicist by the name of P.A.N. Dirac. So antimatter does act just like it does in Star Trek. On the other hand, I was talking about spin. Well, it turns out that the quarks spin. And small objects like this are not like basketballs. If I have a basketball, I could put it on my finger and set it to spinning. I can make it go fast. I can slow it down, spin it slow, and I can do all kinds of things with it. These objects spin in such a way that you can't change their rates of spin. They always spin at the same rate, or either spinning clockwise or anticlockwise, but at the same rate. And we physicists have a number called H-bar that we can measure this rate of spin in terms of. And so these objects, we say, spin at a rate of 1/2 h-bar. Well, you're not quarks and leptons. I like to tell people, you're much more beautiful to look at. Because you are. I mean, our world is full of incredibly beautiful structures, complicated structures, not just this soup of particles floating around. And why is that the case? Well, the answer is that these particles are held in rigid patterns by forces. And what we can tell from our study of science is that there are 4 forces in nature that we've found so far. There's the gravitational force. Keeps you comfortably seated in your chair. Galactic formation. The large-scale structure of our universe is governed by the force of gravity. Planetary motion. Wobbly stars. We've been using the fact that gravity, that as a planet orbits a star, it causes the star to wobble. We've been using that fact to discover planets for the course of the last 5 to 10 years. Black holes, a topic that we will come to earlier. And, of course, falling apples. That is Sir Isaac's contribution, apples and gravity and moons and what have you. There's something else in nature called the weak interaction. It's a form of nuclear energy. This is a picture of the USS Enterprise. It was the first nuclear-powered carrier in the world, and that's the only reason why I use it as a background, because it has that connection to the weak nuclear force. But the weak nuclear force we can see in beta decay, natural radioactivity, we first discovered that nature allowed radioactivity near the end of the 1800s. This was done because there are substances like pitchblende and other substances that have a natural sort of glow to them. We designed most of our reactors are designed to take advantage of the weak interaction. There's the electromagnetic interaction. Boy, we sure know a lot about that. Computers, the very device that's generating these images, our cell phones, our beepers, the technology that's recording me, all of that comes about because we know how to manipulate and understand the laws of electricity and magnetism. So, in fact, our whole information age society has come about because we understand this part of our universe very well. And then finally, there's the strong interaction. And the strong interaction is, in fact, the source of the energy by which the sun derives its power. We get our light and heat from
fusion reactions. We also construct things like the Fat Man.
Well, what's the Fat Man?
Well,
it's an atomic bomb. It's a second atomic bomb that our species constructed and that the United States dropped on Nagasaki. It's a very interesting device. It's an implosion device. It's a big sphere. You put explosives all around the outside of it, and those explosions go off and crush the sphere down. And when you crush the sphere down, you, in fact, can start a chain reaction, and we get a nuclear explosion. Well, a nuclear explosion actually turns out not to be the same as the source here, because that nuclear explosion really is a fission-derived explosion. However, using devices like that, there's a secondary stage in something called the Teller-Ulam procedure, where we know how to take the energy from that first nuclear explosion and then use that to start to burn hydrogen. And when you burn hydrogen, you're doing what the sun does. The sun burns hydrogen, converting it into helium. That's where it gets its energy from. So, interestingly enough, the strong force has this dual character. It provides us with a source of light because all energy on Earth is ultimately derived from the sun. And secondly, in our own hands, we have learned how to take this same energy source and construct devices so powerful that we can literally end all life on Earth. There's a story about Edward Teller one day, and someone walked into his office, and on the top of his blackboard was a heading that said, delivery devices. And then under that, he had airplanes, ships, missiles, and the last delivery device was backyard. So someone walked in and saw this and said, I understand the first three of these delivery devices for how to take a nuclear weapon and destroy our enemies, but how does this last one work? And Teller's response was very simple. You build a thermonuclear weapon large enough so that when you set it off in your backyard, it blows part of the atmosphere of the Earth off. And we know how to do that. That's the power of thermonuclear weapons. You can actually blow the atmosphere off the planet. So this is rather frightening stuff, but I tell people that I prefer to have an informed public to know where we are in our technological development as opposed to an ill-informed public. All this stuff comes from studying these tiny things. As I was saying earlier, electrons and quarks spin at a rate of 1/2 h-bar, but there's lots of stuff in nature besides electrons that we see spinning at different rates. There are particles called deltas and sigma that spin at 3/2 and 5/2 h-bar. In fact, there's no reason not to suppose that you can find things spinning at any integer divided by 1/2 over h-bar. And all of those things share a property with the electron that we'll come to later. But the particle of light, the photon, also spins. But it doesn't spin at the same rate. It spins at twice the rate of the photon, of the electron. So the photon spins at a rate of 1, not 1/2. So it's twice as fast as spinning. And again, it either spins, if it's moving this way, it spins in a clockwise sense or a counterclockwise sense. There's something in nature that we believe is out there called the Higgs particle, which the LHC will spend a fair fraction of time looking for once it comes online, sometime after the year 2007 or so. It is a piece of matter that the likes of which we've never seen in the laboratory. But in fact, it's very much like one of these things, like our story with Maxwell, where Maxwell writes an equation and predicts something that says signals move, and then you go to the laboratory and you see it. Well, there's a theory by Glashow, Salam, and Weinberg that has predicted that you ought to see this thing. It's a kind of mysterious particle that is responsible for all the other particles receiving their mass, apparently. And so it will have a rate of 0. And then the graviton, something that I will come to later, but the graviton actually spins at 4 times the rate of the electron. Now, things that spin at 1/2 the rate have a very curious property. Things that spin at 1/2 rates, you can never put two of them at the same place at the same time. They have an inherent ability to repel each other, even if you turned off all the electrical forces in the world. It's called the exclusion principle. On the other hand, things like photons, you can put as many photons in the same place at the same time as you want with the same energy. So integer spin objects the cartoon I like to tell people about is consider the following. Take one water hose along the line of this arm and take a second water hose and turn it like this. And then when you say go, I turn the water hoses on. And
and they have high pressure. So what happens after you say go? The water comes gushing out the end. The two streams bump into each other, and I get splattered, right? Now, if you could turn off all the electrical charges in water, because after all, water is composed of protons and electrons, and if somehow you magically can still make it water, and you did this experiment, they would still scatter, even if you turned off all the charges, because the Pauli exclusion principle actually is an inherent repulsive force between fermions. It has nothing to do with the charges they carry. On the other hand, if I take a flashlight like this, and a second flashlight like this, and stand in a dark room with some dust in the air, and you say, go, well, let me, in fact, take the dust out of the air, and you say, go, the two flashlight beams can go right through each other perfectly undisturbed. They, A, have no electrical charge, which is why they can pass through each other, and B, at least classically, because they are bosons, there is no Pauli exclusion principle that stops them from doing so. You, by the way, since you're full of electrons and protons and stuff like that, can't go through stuff. But I guess you already knew that. I'm sorry, let me back up a moment. Okay, there we go. How do the forces work? Well, when you're in high school and going through early years of college, people come along and say, aha, Newton told us that the force of attraction between the Earth and the Moon goes like the product of their masses divided by the square of the distance, multiplied by a constant that we call Newton's constant. Two electrons repel each other by the square of their charges divided by the square of distance. Now, these equations involve a piece of magic. And the magic that they involve, which was, in fact, illustrated in episode 1 of The Elegant Universe, is that if these equations were exactly the way that our universe worked, they imply that at the instant that something occurs here on Earth, a billion, billion, billion light years away, that is known because the force of gravity changes. You see, this equation has no time dependence in it. It says, as soon as I change R, everywhere and magically, the force of gravity has changed. So if I have my pen here, and there's some alien out in another galaxy, and that alien has a technology to measure the gravitational attraction between their device and my pen, as soon as I do this, at the instant I do this, according to that equation, the alien knows. Well, stop and think about it for a moment. That's not the way our universe works. In our universe, when something happens at one place, like if I were, my president probably wouldn't like this, but I'm going to use it anyway. If I were a terrorist, terrorist, according to my president. If I were a terrorist, I would stand here and set off a bomb. Now, there would have been an explosion and a shockwave, but since I'm being recorded back there, what would actually happen is that the shockwave would take some amount of time before it would get from the location of the bomb and then out, and if it were sufficiently powerful enough, destroy us all, that would be the end of my lecture. It takes time for the information of the explosion to occur there before it is known somewhere else. This example says it takes no time for the gravitational force to work that way. This is not the way our universe works. And in fact, one of the neat things about someone like Isaac Newton, who was the person who proposed that equation, is that he himself understood that there was something wrong with it. If you actually read the Principia, which is where he talks about this, you will find out that he talks about, essentially, his discomfort with the idea that action at a distance can occur. And yet, experimentally, we know that this works because it explains why the moon stays orbiting around the Earth. It explains how the Earth stays in orbit around the sun. We have used that equation to maneuver our spaceships from Earth to, most recently, Mars, with Spirit and the recent landing. So the equation works at some level, but it cannot be the exact truth. Well, we know how to get out of this for forces like electromagnetism. And the way that you get out of it is that you say, when you have something like an electron, all around it, like a big spherical porcupine, there's hair. And that hair is the electrical field. And so when someone draws a picture of an electron as a dot, if it has charge, it's got all this invisible hair. We saw some of this hair earlier today not electrical hair, but there's also magnetic hair. And we saw that today, at least those in the school here, when Dr. Becker took her experiment and started pouring the iron filings down on, you saw this nice little pattern occur around the iron bars. Those iron filings line up around the magnetic hair, the invisible magnetic hair that comes off of magnets. A similar kind of invisible hair exists around charged particles. And the thing that's neat about this hair is that when you move a charged particle, the hair itself has to move. Now, that makes sense. If you, one thing I often tell people is, you know, in the United States, we have these commercials about of shampoos. And so they have this model come out with this long, flowing hair, and she stands it and does like this. And then you watch, if you look at her hair, as opposed to other parts, what you'll see is that the waves of motion along her hair don't immediately, when she turns her head, it's not like the hair instantly moves. You can see the disturbance as it moves out along the hair. That's what this idea tells us, is that once you know that there's hair attached to charged particles, then when you move the charged particle, the hair's got to move. And this hair is what's responsible for the force that transmits between two electrons. And so here we can see the hair as it's moving about, although this image actually has some issues that I don't want to talk about. We'll have to redo that one. Let me explain this in a different way. If we have two electrons, and that's what I have here at the bottom of this transparency, and one is moving along in space and time, at a certain point it might decide to emit a particle of light, a photon, that can then travel through space and time to the location of a second particle, and when it gets there, it tells the second particle, there's another electron close by, you ought to be repelled. It takes some time for that message carrier to do that. Well, this flash that you see in the middle is the photon. Now, don't go off and tell people that Jim Gates said that if you look very carefully about two repelling electrons, that you're going to see little flashes of light, because you're not. Mathematically, there are things called virtual photons that are responsible for this force, and that's what I represent by this cartoon. So, this is the way that forces can work in such a way that there is now a time delay when something happens. When something happens, so you shake the hair here, it takes some amount of time for the message to go out to the hair, along the hair, to a second object that's sensitive to the hair. How do we know that I haven't been lying to you? Well, earlier I talked about accelerators. And this is a cartoon of an accelerator known as SLAC, where there's an experiment known as Babar. Some of you probably recognize this character. In our guys, this is related to the fact that this experiment works on particles that are called B particles and anti-B particles, which are called B bar particles. So you put that together, it becomes Babar. What does it look like? Well, this thing here is over a kilometer long. It's basically a big electron gun. So you fire electrons down this object. You also fire their antiparticles, protons. The red lines, you see these little red lines, those represent the electrons. The blue lines represent protons. So you, they're anti-electrons. So you shoot them down this beam. You split them apart into two places. You make them go around this circular racetrack using magnetic fields. And then you take the two opposite traveling bunches, and you bend the track so that they bump into each other. And at that place, which is normally called an interaction region, which Zeb can tell you about in great detail for any of those of you who want to learn such things, at those regions, you start building devices to see what happens when you get the bumping. And this is a representation of one such device. This isn't very impressive, except that it's drawn to scale. This is the size of a person against this device known as the Babar detector at SLAC. It is a several hundred million dollar device that is multi-stories high. These are huge devices. They are not tabletop. We're not talking about tabletop science here. And for those devices, what do you get? Because, by the way, if I was in the country, in the U.S., I would say, you folks pay for this when you pay for your taxes. But since I'm in South Africa, I can't say that. But you can laugh at the Americans for paying for this. For $750 million a year, because that's how much money is spent in the United States doing this kind of science. It comes from principally the Department of Energy. $750 million a year. For that $750 million a year, my community, well, not us theorists, because we don't do anything, but experimentalists come back and present to the government and to us theorists things that look like this. Now, I have a set of 10-year-old twins, and they can draw pretty well. They can draw lines on paper. And I've been trying to find someone who will pay us just a fraction of, you know, a sizable fraction of that $750 million for me to bring some of their drawings to them and say, look what my children could do. But yet, the government supports this kind of research. It's because of this that we know about these things like quarks and leptons and the Higgs particles. It comes out of this research. Let me talk about quantum mechanics. Let's see. Oh, yeah. Jacques, can you help me? Okay. Simple eraser, stand back. Simple eraser. You're going to watch a scientific experiment here. I'm going to throw the eraser to Jacques, and I hope he can catch it. And he did. Now, you might not think that that's remarkable at all. I mean, you could, after all, I mean, you can go and don't throw it back. I can't catch it. You can go in many places, in villages and cities and towns and farms, and see children throwing balls back and forth all the time. So you think there's nothing remarkable about that. But in fact, there's something very remarkable about that. Because if you, and the way to know that is to have small kids. I remember when my kids were like 3 and 4. And I'd come home and they'd come and say hi to daddy. And I would want to play catch with them. So I'd say, okay, well, let's play catch. And you toss something to them, and the first thing they want to do is run to you to catch it. You say, you want this ball? Oh, right? They run to you. Because they haven't yet learned that when objects are tossed, they follow these nice arcing paths that we call the classical trajectory. When you get to be your age, or actually much younger than you are, when someone says, I'm going to throw you something, you don't think of yourself, oh, I got to go running into where that thing is. What you do, and by the way, we're not the only creatures that do this, because many of us, many species on Earth are capable of catching things in flight. And in order to do that, you have to understand the classical path. So what you do at some part of your brain, which is not mathematics, is you integrate Newton's second law. You do calculus without knowing it's calculus that you're doing. You figure out, well, it's going to do something like that. And then all you have to do to catch is in your mind kind of figure, where do I have to put my hand so that I intersect that path? You don't go running after it, right? You rely on the fact that it's going to travel this classical path. So there's nothing mysterious about that. You say, oh, yeah, we all know that. Even animals know that. Yeah, you're right. Suppose Jacques and I repeated this experiment, but this time, this is an electron. Not an eraser, but an electron. So one more time, we're going to do our experiment. I'm going to stand here. I'm going to toss my electron. Okay, so it stars Jacques, but then it sees John and finds him quite attractive. So it comes over here and orbits around his head 137 times, and then finally goes and proceeds to Jacques' hands. Now, you've never seen a real object do that. If I tossed the chalk and that occurred, you would say that that was some kind of a cartoon. That doesn't happen in our world. For electrons, that can happen. Electrons are not bound to follow the classical path. The laws of motion for electrons are governed by something we call quantum mechanics. They're not Newton's second law. And quantum mechanics allow for precisely what I just described to happen. Now, in quantum mechanics, what we say is the following. Let's compare this. On this transparency, what I have is our baseball, and we're trying to compare the path of the baseball to the path of the electron. The electron of the ball starts someplace. That's me tossing. And then they end up someplace. That's Jacques catching them. But in between, the electron could have traveled along this wiggle path. There's nothing that stops it. It is allowed by its laws of motion to do this. Now, each path, in fact, has a probability. So you can assign that. You can say that the classical path turns out to be the most likely path that the electron took. But it's not the only path that it can take. And these other paths are all allowed. Now, this was all discovered in the 1930s. That's how quantum mechanics got off the ground. And by the way, it's important that we know this, because the other part of building devices like this is using the laws of quantum mechanics. So a lot of people say, you know, that quantum stuff, gee, that's so weird. You know, I don't want to learn that stuff. That can't be real. Well, if you don't believe in quantum mechanics, you should not be allowed to use one of these. Because this is how they work. So now let's go back. So in quantum mechanics, all you can say is, I knew the beginning of a situation, I know the end of a situation, but you can't know what happens in the middle. So let's apply this logic to our electrons repelling each other. Here's our two electrons again, traveling along. This one comes along. It, at this point, emits a virtual photon, which intercepts a second, tells it to be repelled. Well, that's one possibility. And then let's say we start off by knowing the two electrons were here at the bottom, and then at a later time, we see them at the top. And so this is one possibility of what could have happened in the middle. But quantum mechanics says you can't know precisely what happened. So let's see if we can find another possibility. How about this? Our two electrons start at the bottom. Here they are. And our first one comes traveling along. But at this point, it emits a particle of light, which travels on a separate path and is later reabsorbed by the same electron. And then it continues. And then in the intervening period, it emits a second photon, which in fact winds up carrying the message that says you ought to be repelled. And then you'll notice the thing that's interesting about this picture is the beginning of this picture and the very end of this picture are exactly the same as before. Well, let's try one more time. We could perhaps have something like this happen. Our electron comes along, it's traveling through space and time, and then when it gets to this point, it emits a photon. That photon travels along for some while, and then it disappears because Einstein says that energy and mass are the same thing. So this photon has some amount of energy, but suppose all that energy got suddenly converted back into mass. It could do so if it's a particle and an antiparticle that's created at the point where the photon disappears, thereby allowing conservation of mass energy. The electron goes zipping away in one direction, the positron in the other, but the electron and positron have opposite charges. Opposite charged particles attract. And so even though they might have spontaneously come into existence pointing in opposite directions, the attractive force between them eventually tries to pull them back together. And when they get back together, which occurs over here, well, then it's Kirk and anti-Kirk. They destroy each other. Converting all their mass and energy back into pure energy carried by a second photon, which is then absorbed by our second electron. The beginning of this diagram and the end of this diagram are exactly the same. Now, these kinds of diagrams I've shown you are actually, they're like the music to a very complicated score. The score is called quantum field theory. If you actually sat down and tried to figure out the score that sits behind this picture, in the same way that a score sits behind a tune that you would hear. The score behind this is quantum field theory, and it was, in fact, raised to this level of understanding by Richard Feynman and Tomonaga. They won a Nobel Prize for figuring out how to use this score to figure out these answers. But these pictures convey a great essence of the mathematics. And in fact, if you take a course in quantum field theory, there are people like myself and Cliff and Don and a few others that will show you how to take these pictures and convert them back into the score. In fact, after my talk today, if someone wants to see the score from one of these, I'll be very happy to write it down for you. They're called Feynman graphs, after Richard Feynman. And so, in fact, it turns out that this is how forces work. But there's a very interesting consequence of this. You see, since these pictures are actually mathematics, you can ask me what force law does this first picture represent. And it turns out it's E squared over R squared. So it's the usual repulsion between electrons. These other pictures, in fact, give different functions of position, velocities, and even spins in terms of the repulsive force. Electrons don't just repel each other by 1 over R squared, it turns out. There's much more complicated force laws involved. So if you very carefully measure the forces on electrons, you can see if these other pictures are there. There's a very famous experiment that was actually mentioned earlier today by Melanie Becker called the G-2 experiment. G-2 experiment has been underway for a good almost 50 years now. It's an experiment where you look to see whether these mathematical pictures compares to what you see in the laboratory. And it turns out that to 12 decimal places now, there is agreement. This is the best tested piece of science that I know about.
So again, for the people who don't believe in quantum mechanics, we've got tons of data that say that you were wrong. Quantum mechanics is actually there. And it turns out not just the gravitational, not just the electromagnetic forces, but all of the four forces that I named, we believe ought to work by pictures like this. This is called relativistic quantum field theory. Now, you can apply this idea to Einstein's theory of gravitation, because Einstein is the one who taught us how to work the time delay and the exchange of gravitational forces. But if you do that and apply Feynman's rules, you'll find, well, between the Earth and the Moon, you can exchange this thing we call the graviton, the thing that spins at four times the rate of the electron, and do the mathematics, figure out what the force law is, and it turns out it will give you, gee, what you expect. There's an attractive force that goes like the product of masses divided by the square of distance times g. Great. But remember, what quantum mechanics is when you're not looking, you can't tell what happened. So in between, so the beginning and the end here are exactly the same as the beginning and the end there. Quantum mechanics says both of these are allowed. That's like that wandering electron. And if you try to do this calculation, you'll find out that the force between the Earth and Moon is infinite. That ought to disturb you. Because if the force between the Earth and Moon were infinite, the Moon would be here. It would not be 240,000 miles away. So there's something wrong. There's something wrong with what we've just talked about. Nature, after all, as Cliff properly corrected me today, something I know, nature is the final arbiter of truth as far as physicists are concerned. So when you do a piece of mathematics like this that gives you an answer that is inconsistent with what you can see, that means that you have to give up your mathematics. Science is unlike other systems of human belief. In science, we derive our fundamental power and prowess from the statement that we don't know the answer a priori. We must find the answer. There is no sacred truth that comes down to us. Every generation of scientists is responsible for looking at what previous generations have said and figure out which parts are right and which parts are wrong. This is fundamentally different from many, many human systems of belief. In lots of systems of belief, people believe there's some truth that was given and that is inviolate. That's not the way science works. Science is precisely the opposite. We say that we're limited in our ability to know. We didn't come here knowing everything. Therefore, we have to find out. Science is a method for finding out. One thing I'd say about science often is that if you ask young people what's science, they'll say, well, science is what you find in a science book. But see, that's just like walking into the studio of a sculptor and looking at the floor and saying, oh, yes, sculptors are people who create little blocks of rocks on the floor. Having missed entirely the sculpture. It's the knowledge that we create that is science. It's not the results that we find. It's the knowledge. Science is a method for finding the truth in physical reality as best we can do it. That's what science is. So, let's talk about quantum mechanics and relativity. Special relativity works for all the forces. Quantum theory didn't work for gravity up until the 60s. This is a very interesting story, because people figured out that quantum mechanics and gravity were inconsistent about the 1930s. Long, long time ago this was known. But we physicists, being the bright people we are, never told anybody else. We simply didn't. We would have discussions among ourselves about this problem, but we wouldn't go out public and say, oh my God, there's a fundamental disconnect between two things that we believe. Now, again, physicists are thought to be like really smart people. I mean, if you go out in the general public and say, you know, that's a physicist, oh, it's like all brain, right? I mean, I'm sure you've heard these kinds of things. And so physicists are not typically expected to behave like other people. Now, for most folks, if they have a problem, what's their first reaction to the problem?
Find somebody smart to consult.
Well, if you really want to solve, but what else could you do? I'm sorry?
Denial!
Right? Denial! We all do this. If there's a problem and you really don't want to deal with it, you'll just say, it's not a problem. Now, you don't probably expect physicists to behave that way, but that's exactly what we did for about 50 years. We knew that there was this disconnect between quantum mechanics and relativity. But then very bright people said, oh, well, it's not really a disconnect. What's really going on here is that the force of gravity comes from the curvature of space, and that is fundamentally different from the other forces. So lots of people, you know, said, okay, fine, I won't worry about it. Other people made a more practical statement saying, these quantum effects that would be for gravity, how would you measure them? And the answer, which we still give today, by the way, is, I'm sorry, we have not the technology to go look at the effects of quantum gravity. Remember, for the electromagnetic forces, I told you there's a number we can check to 12 decimal places. We see it works. If you tried that same thing for gravity, it turns out that we don't have the technology to go and check. So how would you know whether quantum mechanics was there for gravity? That's a practical point of view. And large groups of physicists took that point of view and said, because we can't do an experimental determination, we don't need to worry about the inconsistency of these two things that we believe. But not everyone did that. And in particular, one person who, in a very striking manner, sought to try to figure out what was going on in this disconnect was Stephen Hawking. Now, Stephen Hawking is known for a piece of work, which is, I've got a cartoon here, and you'll notice that there's a distortion, as it says, before Hawking going across here. This is sort of what you would see if a black hole were to pass in between you and the night sky. You would see the lights, the stars would seem like they would move and shift their position. Because it turns out that although nothing can escape a black hole, you can graze against black holes. They have something called an event horizon, and it turns out that if you have something that occurs outside of the event horizon, it's like normal space. So the light from the stars gets bent around the black hole. That's what you see when the first part of my cartoon runs. Hawking, after trying to worry about quantum mechanics, figured out that black holes, if they're there at all, and are consistent with the laws of quantum mechanics, that there's a kind of sizzling, like static around them. And that's what I have on the bottom part of my card. These little dots are a cartoon representation of something called Bekenstein-Hawking radiation. There's a kind of sizzle around black hole. If you were able to put particle detectors there, you would see something coming out. That's what Hawking said. Now, where does this result come from? If you read Hawking's paper, it reminds me of a lot of the homework I get as a physics teacher. If you teach students physics and say, prove this, given X, prove Y, often you'll get the homework back from your students. Almost every student at the bottom of the page will have, yes, I have proved it, check mark. But if you now read the paper bottom to top and then top to bottom, often it's the case that right in the middle, there's no logical connection, right? It's as if an act of God happened, and boom, they were ready to go. Now, the problem with this analogy is Hawking's paper is precisely of this nature. If you actually start reading at the front of the paper and then at the end and start going towards the middle, what you find is that at a certain point, he has to make some assumptions about things that are called gray-body. Where do these assumptions come from? There is no mathematically rigorous way to prove that his assumptions are correct. But he has very deep insight into how things ought to work. And this is a great example of how what one's imagination does controls the mathematics, not the reverse. Because he had an insight, he had an idea about how it ought to work. And then he enforced that on the mathematics. And out at the end of the day comes Hawking radiation. So at that stage, what we find is that there's a sort of a disconnect in physics, and this disconnect was there, except that for guys like Hawking, they said, these two things ought to be consistent. Even if I don't know the mathematics to make them consistent, it ought to be. It turns out that string theory appears to be one piece of mathematics that resolves these two very different things. Here I have a cartoon of what is a string. This blob of light represents a particle. Now, a particle is actually a ball that you shrink to no size at all. A fundamental particle has no size. It's a geometrical point particle. When you were in school, maybe you remember this thing called the number line, and every point on the line is associated with a number.
But I don't know about you, but I remember asking students, well, how big is a point? And the teacher's answer was, well, it has no size. And then I said, well, how can you take these things that have no size and stack them up and get something that has a length? I've never quite resolved that, but I've become comfortable with the notion. So geometrical point particles are what Newton's law is all about. It's not about real objects. He writes about geometrical point particles. In fact, all of physics for 2,000 years is based on the notion that geometrical point particles enter our description at some level. Now, you might say, well, wait, didn't quantum mechanics say that we got away from particles? Well, yeah, but the argument of the wave function is the geometrical point particle. So geometrical point particles were there. What about Einstein? Didn't he get away from point particles? No. All Einstein did is said that you consider point particles in a four-dimensional universe, not a three-dimensional one. So point particles was under all of our physics for about 2,000 years. Got us to the moon, got us high technology. Great idea runs us smack into a wall in this trying to resolve this conflict. So a point particle, I use this blob of light to represent something that you couldn't see otherwise. A string, we believe, is an extended object. So it's something that is kind of like a point particle, but you kind of stretch the particle out. It has a length, but it has no thickness whatsoever. So it's infinitely thin, but it has a length. Now, if it's anything like a real string, it can move, or it can vibrate. Real strings, in fact, you've been listening to a certain string vibrate for about 40 minutes now. Strings vibrate. They make sounds. And so these tiny things, if they're there, they're allowed to vibrate. So we physicists like to use the word expressions, normal modes. So these tiny objects, if they're there, must support normal modes. And this is a property that no particle could possess. Strings come in open and closed varieties. An open string is a string whose ends are free. A closed string, you take the two ends and you join them together. And so I often tell people that strings are like little pieces of spaghetti. So that's spaghetti, and that's SpaghettiOs. Closed and open strings are both allowed to move. So here's one of our closed strings vibrating and moving simultaneously in this cartoon. And again, my cartoons are representations for large numbers of equations. Never think when you hear a talk like this or see the Elegant Universe that you have understood string theory, because you haven't. The way that we humans understand these things is that you fully engage the mathematics. That's when you can say, I understand, not before. When strings were first thought of, around 68 or so, people looked to see whether they really were consistent with special relativity, and it turned out that in a very curious way they were not. That is, there's a certain property of special relativity that is obeyed for point particles, that when you try to take strings and put them in the same place and do the same mathematical calculation, what you find is that the laws of Einstein break down with the idea of string theory, unless, very big unless there are 25 spatial dimensions. That's bizarre. In our universe, there are three. I can move front and back, I can move side to side, and I can move up and down, and anything else I do is a combination of those three basic motions. String theory says you have to have a universe where there are 25 basic motions, or else the laws of special relativity don't work. Well, this was found by young people, and when they went to their advisors, I have this dream that some young scientist went to his advisor and said, I've got this great theory of physics. The world has 25 directions. Now, this was in the 60s and 70s, so you can imagine that this young person comes to his advisor and makes a statement. And remember, in the 60s and 70s, there were lots of pharmaceutical and pharmacological experiments going on, unauthorized ones. So you can imagine this old physics professor having this young student come in and say, there are 25 directions. And then the professor begins to wonder, what has the student been doing? Is it physics or something else? That killed string theory the first time around. When that happened, essentially everybody in the world, except for a few people, stopped doing string theory. Among these few people were André Nevers, John Schwartz, and Pierre Rameau, who were postdocs at the time when this discovery was made. Notice, earlier today, for those of you here,
in Tony Z's talk, he underlined the word student. Remember in his talk, he underlined student? Because that's where the future comes from. It doesn't come from old guys who already know a whole lot. It comes from young people with a daring to imagine a different way.
And so that was how string theory got started and died. So these three people I named for you were so intrigued by the idea. And Lenny Susskind was very much involved in the beginning of string, as any of those who have watched The Elegant Universe knows. They were so intrigued by the idea, they tried to save it. They tried to make it the mathematics better so that it could look like our universe. And so if you actually look in hindsight, we can look at what they did. And it looks very simple. What they did is said, well, in our world, when we thought the world was composed of particles, let's look at the properties of particles. They can move, but they also can spin. The original string that was constructed could not spin. So all you had to do was take a property of something that you had seen in nature and incorporate that into the mathematics of this little piece of spaghetti. In a cartoon nature, I would say I would want it to spin on its axis. Cartoon-like, but captures the essence of the idea. And so these young people combine the idea of the string with the idea of spin, leading to what are called spinning strings, and then later to superstrings. You have to do it with mathematics. So you actually have to invent some new kinds of mathematical symbols that go into that score that I showed you in an appropriate way. And when you do that, what you find, it can be done in two ways. There's one way of doing it, which we now call an NSR fermion. That's Nevers-Schwarz-Ramon. There's another way of doing it using the Green-Schwarz fermion, but both of them accomplish the same thing. They allow the piece of spaghetti to spin on its axis. And when you do that and ask the question about consistency with special relativity, you find out that the world only needs to have 9 direct extra spatial directions, not 25. Big improvement, but not our world. In 1984, something very beautiful happened at Princeton. A new kind of string was invented. And the idea for this new string is take a closed string. So here's a closed string that I have over here. And let's watch it as it vibrates. So here it is. In fact, I'm going to need about another 15 or 20 minutes. So let me offer the opportunity for, if you're tired and like to leave, please take this opportunity so we can keep a disturbance to the audience to a minimum. Thank you for coming. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
I might want to make that another 10 minutes.
Okay, 10 minutes, I'll be done. The boss has spoken. I have 10 minutes to finish this off. Okay, so in 1984, people at Princeton noticed the following property about strings, that if you take a closed string and watch it vibrate, it can vibrate as we've done here. And if you watch that vibration, you'll notice there's something interesting about it. There are places on the string that, as it was vibrating, don't move. There are nodes of the vibration. So that's one kind of motion that a string can perform without moving. Well, here's something else it could do. It could vibrate, but then those nodes could rotate in either a right-handed sense or in a left-handed sense. And it turns out that the mathematics of this idea is actually internally consistent, something that had not been realized before. Now, one of the beautiful things about this construction, the heterotic string, is that it is so close to reality that you can do the following experiment. You can give this mathematics to a mathematician who has never taken a physics course, but is a good mathematician, nevertheless. The mathematician can come back and begin to tell you things like, there's something called energy, and it is conserved. There's something called momentum, it's conserved. There's something called electrical charge, and it is conserved. And if the mathematician is really good, he or she can derive Maxwell's equations, can derive the Dirac equation, can derive Einstein and Yang-Mills equations, all from this single piece of mathematics without ever having had a course in physics. The heterotic string idea is so potent that all the essential parts of our description of nature are actually contained there once you take these cartoons and write out their mathematical score. So that was a great triumph of the heterotic string. It still lived in 9 dimensions, by the way. It
didn't quite get to four yet,
but it lived in nine. And so I want to talk about now something that's not often talked about in the literature, because most people will tell you strings have to live in more than four dimensions. Turns out that is not technically correct. A string can actually live in four dimensions, but there's a trick for how to make it do so. And I happen to know this is right because I spent a lot of time in the 80s looking very carefully at this issue about whether strings had to live in extra dimensions. The statement I make to people is strings are allowed to live in higher dimensions, but they are not demanded to be living in higher dimensions. And why do I say that? Well, Professor Z talked about gauge theory today and differential forms. And if you talk to mathematicians about those topics, they will tell you that there's a mathematical structure there called a fiber bundle. And so if you take the notion that strings ought to be structures that exist on fiber bundles, not just on space-time, it turns out that you can get to four dimensions relatively simply. So the notion is that strings are simplest if you believe in higher dimensions. Much simpler to write the equations. But if you say that I live in an essentially four-dimensional world, there is an open avenue by which one can explore the notion of string theory. Intellectually, it occurs in the following sort of way. For an ordinary string, we had no movers, or rather standing wave modes. We had right movers. In order to get a four-dimensional string, it turns out you need more right movers than you did in 10 dimensions. But the price you pay is you also have to introduce extra left-moving modes. Now, these purely right-moving and left-moving modes are things that live on the fiber. So that's their mathematical interpretation. So it's possible, actually, to construct these things. They're much more difficult to construct than ordinary higher-dimensional strings. So elegance, at least a certain kind of elegance, does indeed suggest higher dimensions. But it doesn't demand higher dimensions, which is something people often say in our business, that string theories demand higher dimensions. That's not a true statement. So in the original heterotic string, there was a formulation called the fermion formulation. I've written the score here in some nice, concise language called superfields. There's a formulation B, which is in the original paper of Gross and Company. There's also a formulation C, and that formulation is actually due to myself and Warren Siegel. And in this formulation, it's the one where you make completely manifest the fiber bundle structure of the 10-dimensional heterotic string. So it turns out that string theory can exist peacefully in four dimensions. Let me move in, since I have only 5 minutes now, because I have the obligatory run-on time, right? Kind of. Let me end by talking about an interesting idea that many of us have been looking about and thinking about, namely the idea of M-theory. I took you all the way from particles to pieces of spaghetti. But, you know, you could actually stop me and say, wait a minute, suppose I had a really, really powerful microscope, and I decide to look at the strings again. Then under your powerful microscope, who knows? Maybe you could isolate a fundamental entity that, in fact, is how the string gets built up. And since it's infinitesimal, it would have to be a point particle, or something, a point particle-like object that we would call a zero brain, or an imparton. So M-theory, which has been underway for about 6 years, is partly related to this idea that the string itself actually might have a substructure. And this is most powerfully seen in the construction that came from Susskind and Company at Stanford, where they wrote down the mathematics for this substructure and then showed that when you do that, you get a theory that we had never been able to connect to string theory before, namely 11-dimensional supergravity. So it comes directly out of this idea. The last thing I want to say a few words about is brains, which was actually the title of this talk. The notion of the brain is a very intriguing one. And the essential way to understand it is imagine two planes of glass. But suppose those planes of glass were the entire universe, everything that we know. You could imagine, since string theory does allow for extra dimensions, you could imagine that, in fact, that there are such planes that we actually exist on, that these are the so-called membranes that you hear in the brain scenario. So you can imagine looking at a particular model, which was, in fact, invented by Neil Turok and Company, where they said, suppose you try to imagine the physics as two of these brains encounter each other. What does that look like? what they found was something very interesting, namely that the temperatures and densities on the surface of the brains rise to an infinite point and then begin to drop again. What does that remind you of that we know from our science happened in our universe? The Big Bang. And so this was one toy model. It has some problems, but this is one toy. I hear Cliff laughing. This is one idea that can be explored about how our universe could, in fact, exist like a sheet of glass in a bigger universe. Another thing about brains, the other things that I didn't have time to put in this cartoon, is you can imagine that there are open strings stretched between these objects. And so, in fact, once you get to the notion of brains and D-brains, you can, in fact, go back and start to connect what we used to think of as separate theories. They all get merged into this single conglomeration that we don't have a really good feeling for. It's called M-theory. And that's where we sit today in our physics and our explanation of the fundamental. We're wondering about this thing called M-theory. And so M-theory, well, there's in America, I don't even know if this is true, but in the U.S. I often hear this story that there's an African proverb about how to eat an elephant. One bite at a time. That's what we're doing with M-theory. Thank you.
Well, thank you very, very much for an inspiring talk.
Thank you, Cliff.
And time for questions. Any questions?
I put them all to sleep.
Let me remind you that Jim will be here for a good portion of time over the next, I'm not sure how
week.
Many days,
I
over the next week.
Week, yeah.
And so you'll have a chance to ask questions there and also questions about all sorts of other things. We'll also hear a little bit more of some of the details or some of the other discussions